Let's first read God's word. So if I may be allowed to share on the screen, okay, our text for this evening, which can be found in Galatians chapter 5, verses 7 to 12. I have been doing a series of studies on Galatians, and we have already reached chapter 5, and this is what I'd like to share with you. Let me read. You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? This persuasion is not from him who calls you. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. But if I, brother, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. I wish those who unsettle you would emasculate themselves. Lord, tonight we thank you for the privilege of meditating on your word and for the opportunity to present to you our request, O Lord. Lord, as we study your word this evening, we pray, O Lord, that you will enlighten the eyes of our heart, that your Holy Spirit will accompany us, empower the word that is being shared so that we might really see the importance, the paramount importance of your gospel. May we learn, O Lord, through this study to love what you love. And Lord, we pray also that as this message is being shared, teach us, O Lord, to speak the truth in love, O Lord. We pray that the word, the truths of your word, will not only reach our minds, but it will really sink deeply into our hearts so that we may be transformed, so that we might be a people who live for your glory. Lord, forgive us for our many sins. And we trust, O Lord, that you will really be there for us even as we meditate on your powerful and living word. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Okay. Now, Galatians chapter 5, verses 7 to 10, we will be studying about the gospel. Specifically, actually, I don't want to go deep into this, although I anticipate that this will be a devotional that will be longer than usual, so I might as well ask for your indulgence at this time. I know this might not be proper since this is supposed to be a prayer watch. I will try to keep this as short as possible, although I doubt that I can really, keep this shorter than 30 minutes. But anyway, okay, anyway, the title of the message is actually Beware of False Teachers. It's actually part two of a much of a message on staying free in Christ. Because if you look at the passage, if you look at the earlier passages, verses, you will read about the freedom wherein Christ has set us free. And there are two main points. The first point is, if you want to stay free in Christ, then you must beware of falling away. I will not talk about that tonight. Secondly, if you want to stay free in Christ, you must beware of false teaching and false teachers. Okay, let me give you a little background. Paul, of course, is a gospel preacher. He loves the gospel very much. He was a person who will die for the gospel. And so he taught the Galatians about the gospel, which is simply that our salvation is by grace through faith in Christ alone, not by works. Then here comes, I believe, some people from Jerusalem, if I am not mistaken. They are allegedly Christians, allegedly, but they have a different gospel, okay? They believe that Christ is not enough for salvation. You must also keep the law. You must also rely on your performance. You must rely on your ability to save yourself. Yes, they mention Christ. Yes, they acknowledge, yes, Christ is Lord and Savior, but somehow Christ is not the center. The stress, the emphasis is really ultimately on themselves and their power to save themselves, in this particular instance, in their ability to keep the law, especially circumcision. But again, I won't go deep into that. That is just a background. There are principles involved there. The important thing to note, this is very interesting. According to one commentator, according to one commentary, if you read verse 12, it says, "I wish those who unsettle you would emasculate themselves." I do not know if you are familiar with the definition of the word emasculate. It means, forgive me for being a bit indecent, it means cutting off your genitals. And according to one commentary, this is probably the rudest and the crudest remark that ever fell from the lips of the Apostle Paul. I mean, you might even say that these are words not fitting for an apostle. Imagine he wants these false teachers, these Judaizers, to cut off their genitals and emasculate themselves. But it only shows that Paul was really angry. He was angry because the gospel was being compromised. The gospel was being destroyed. And again, to make it even more interesting, if you have read the book of Philippians, you will find out that there were some in chapter 1. I don't have time to go there. I will just remind you. Maybe you have read this in the course of reading the New Testament. You will remember that there were some people who preached the gospel. Paul was in prison, and some people were preaching the gospel, you know, in support of Paul, and Paul was happy. But there were some people who were preaching the gospel out of envy in order to hurt Paul. But Paul said, the Apostle Paul said, "Still I rejoice as long as the gospel is preached." Do you not notice the contrast, the difference in reactions? Even though there, in the book of Philippians, even though there were people who were trying to hurt him, it did not matter as long as the gospel was preached. But here in Galatians, it's a different story. The gospel was not being preached. Another gospel, a substitute gospel, which is not really the gospel, was being preached. And Paul was so mad that this kind of words, words not fitting for an apostle to utter, he was constrained to say something like this out of provocation and anger. Grabe, no? So this is really serious. So it's very important for us to know the characteristics of false teaching. The teaching that compromises the gospel, that sets aside the gospel, that ultimately might destroy the gospel. Okay. So number one, what are the characteristics? The first characteristic is, let's read first verse 7. "You were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth?" So whatever this false teaching is, it involves setting a hindrance, an obstacle, a stumbling block, so much so that people are, what is this, diverted from obedience to the truth. Now, we have to interpret scripture by scripture. What does Paul mean when he says the truth? What is he referring to? Of course, if you interpret scripture by scripture, you go by the immediate context. You go to Galatians 2:5. I'll just read it to you. I won't, what is this? I won't show it on the screen anymore. So please listen carefully. Let me just adjust the screen so that I can. Okay. In Galatians 2:5, you will find out the definition of truth. Okay? What does it say? What does Galatians 2:5 say? If you have your Bibles, so much the better. Okay? What does it say? It says, "To them we did not yield in submission even for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you." What is this truth which Paul is referring to? The truth of the gospel. Let's go to another passage. I will not show, again, as I said, I will not show it on the screen. If you have your Bibles, refer to it. If not, listen carefully. We now go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. What does the Bible say? It says, In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. So what is the truth that Paul is referring to? It is the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Whatever this false teaching is, somehow it hinders people from embracing the gospel. It diverts their attention from the grace of God in Christ. It diverts their eyes, their hearts, their minds from what is central in the Bible and in the New Testament. What is central? The gospel of your salvation in Christ Jesus, the word of truth. Okay? So, that is what the word truth means in this particular passage. But we will have to go deeper. How does false teaching, the teaching that sets aside the gospel, how does it hinder us from obeying the truth? Okay. It hinders us, listen carefully, from obeying the truth of the gospel of salvation, by exalting the self rather than the power of the Spirit. Is this just arbitrary, what I have just said? No, I'm going by the context. Go to Galatians 3, 1 to 3. Again, I will not show it on the screen, so listen carefully. Here is what the Bible says. Okay, let me go back to even verse 1 of Galatians 3. I might as well show it. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish? Here it is. Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? I really do not have time to go into this deeply. I do not have time to explain or teach about the theology of the flesh. We are not talking here merely of the physical body, but let me just point you to another verse, John 3:5-6. John 3, verses 5 to 6. Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Whatever the flesh might be, it cannot help you enter the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. You have to rely on the power of the Spirit. And this false teaching hinders the gospel, hinders us from embracing the gospel and really sticking to the gospel, because instead our focus, our hearts are diverted to the things of the flesh. What does that mean? Again, let's go to another verse. Romans 8:5-6. Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. Whatever these Judaizers were teaching, one thing is sure. Their teaching was not spiritual. It was focused and concentrated on the things of the flesh. If you have time on your own to study what is the difference between the things of the Spirit and the things of the flesh, I will be very happy if you will do so. But I have to go very fast. Galatians 5:17, here's what the Bible says. Okay? 5:17. The desires of the flesh are against the Spirit. The desires of the Spirit again are against the flesh. These are opposed to each other. So, to cut the long story short, whatever these Judaizers were teaching, one thing is sure. It was against the things of the Spirit. It was opposed to the Spirit of God, because you cannot combine the flesh and the Spirit. These two are opposed to each other. Let me give you an example. You might think that is now becoming very theoretical, but let me give you an example. Many years ago, I was very young, I read a book, okay? The title of the book is You Can If You Think You Can. The author was a Christian minister. The name of the author, I don't know if it's still popular now, some of you might know him, the name was Norman Vincent Peale. I don't know if you've heard about him. He wrote many popular books. The titles are You Can If You Think You Can, The Power of Positive Thinking. But anyway, here's what happened. In one of his books, he was teaching about positive thinking. He said, okay, if you want to really be able to do it, to achieve success, something like that, then you can quote Philippians 4:13. Do you remember Philippians 4:13? What does it say? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But then a question was raised. What if the one who is quoting the verse is not a Christian? You know what Norman Vincent Peale said? It's all right. Just change the word Christ to God. Instead of saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, just read it this way. Read it this way. I can do all things through God who, what's this, strengthens me. Anyway, that is exegetically possible. And of course, Pastor Daryl knows about that, no? And the other pastors. Exegetically, that's possible. But the point I'd like to make is that he was willing. Christ was not central in his heart and mind. He was willing to let go of it in order to cater to people's, what's this, need to feel strengthened. Does not matter if Christ is ejected or evicted. Does not matter. Just change the word. I can do all things through Christ. Through I can do all things through God. Okay? To accommodate the those who are not Christians, but who somehow believe in God. Okay. What else? In one of his books, Norman Vincent Peale said, okay, God is there to be used. He did. And when I read that, I was shocked. I mean, for him, he believes God is there to be used. And I do not know anymore what to say. So let's leave that. This might take an hour if I will go on commenting on that. But that is what we mean, okay? That is what we mean when we say that false teaching hinders us from obeying the truth of the gospel because it exalts self, the flesh, instead of the power of the Spirit by grace in the cross of Christ Jesus. Now, number two, how does false teaching hinder us from obeying the truth? Well, let's go to Galatians 2:20. What does the Bible say? Okay, let's go there. I have been, okay, 2:21, I mean, I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. In other translations, I do not set aside the grace of God. I do not frustrate the grace of God. To make the long story simple so that we can move fast, false teaching exalts self and sets aside the grace of God and the death of Christ. I mean, the gospel is not being emphasized. The gospel of salvation, the death of Christ, the work of Christ on the cross, that is not the emphasis of the false gospel or false teaching. What is emphasized is religious performance, self-effort, the ability to save yourself. I will have more to say about that anymore. And when I say save yourself, I am not merely referring to salvation of the soul. Let's interpret it broadly. Save yourself from sadness, save yourself from, financial troubles, all kinds of things to control your life. So that it will go the way you want to and you will not suffer and you will not experience trouble and pain. I will go back to that. I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go to the second point. Okay. Pastor Daryl, just stop me if I have really exceeded the time. No? 6:27. So, okay. That means I've already been speaking for 27 minutes. For just 2 points, so I'll have to go fast. We have 3 more points to go. This is a verse-by-verse exposition. Okay, verse 8. This persuasion is not from him who calls you. Second characteristic of false teaching. I'm sorry for going very fast. The second characteristic is simply this. This false teaching does not come from God. This persuasion is not from him who calls you. What does that mean? Why do we say that it is not from God? Okay. Go to 1 John 4, verses 1 to 3. Let me read this quickly. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. Every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you heard was coming in and now is in the world already. In other words, false teaching is not from God. And you know that it is not from God because Christ is not really the center. It's connected to what we said. In false teaching, the center is really the self. The needs of the self, the desires of the self, the goals of the self, the fulfillment of the self. But not Christ and his cross. Christ and the cross, they are not central. But according to what we read, it's up to you to understand what 1 John 3 is all about. That is the spirit of the Antichrist. It neither, what is this, confesses Christ nor exalts Christ. Look at Hebrews 12, verse 2. What does the Bible say? Hebrews 12, let me go first to Hebrews 12, verse 2. Okay, I'll just recite it. You're familiar with it. Looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, from first to finish. The Christian life is about focusing our eyes on the Lord, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Do not divert your eyes from what is central. Christ and his cross. The gospel. And in fact, although I will just mention this briefly, this might be off tangent, no? But everything from the Old Testament, from Genesis to Revelation, it's all about Christ. And you have to see that. Otherwise, you will miss the point. Why do I say that? Because Christ himself said, "Search the scriptures, for they are they which testify of me." And the Bible also says, beginning with Moses and throughout the scriptures, prophets, psalms, wisdom, literature, Christ taught about himself. You remember the two disciples at the Emmaus Road? Just research that on your own, but I hope you remember that. Beginning, it's all about Christ, but let me leave that because, as I said, we have no time. Okay. But here's the important question, and this is very serious. I feel deeply about this. Sometimes I get provoked, but I will have to say this for the glory of God. If it is not from God, the question to us is, where does it come from? Teaching that sets aside the grace of God in Christ Jesus and does not focus the eyes on Christ as the author and finisher of our faith, but instead diverts it to the flesh, where does it come from? The answer is found in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 4 to 5. I will just read it, but listen carefully. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Are you not frightened by that verse? Are you not frightened? Satan does not mind the preaching and teaching of Norman Vincent Peale. When Norman Vincent Peale teaches about positive thinking and you can if you think you can. When Napoleon Hill teaches about think and grow rich. When Robert Schuller, who's also supposed to, a Christian minister, supposed to be, preaches possibility thinking, Satan does not mind because it will not snatch people from his kingdom. But when the gospel is preached, laina na yung istorya. Satan is so mad when the gospel is preached because that means people are being saved. That is why I do not understand any preaching that does not somehow draw out Christ from the passage. Okay? As Lord and Savior. In all of my preaching, you have noticed somehow John 3:16, even a sermon on anxiety, the storm meets God, it ends up with John 3:16. Because Christ is always there. The gospel is always there. We just need eyes to find it. Satan will not mind other kinds of teaching. Does not save anyone. But when the gospel is preached, it is the power of God unto salvation. Okay, verse 9. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. Okay, I grew up in a bakery. Some of you do not know this. I grew up in a bakery. 30 years we had a bakery. It was, this is not to boast. I hope I am truthful when saying it was very well known for hot pandesal. Okay? I did not engage really in baking, but I at least know that when you bake, kundi may masa, may daw, you just, you know, introduce a pinch of yeast. Gamay lang, bisan gamay lang a yeast, and the daw will... The dough, sorry. May arat diga correct sang akon pronunciation. Then the dough will rise. The problem with false teaching that exalts self and sets aside the gospel is that it's very influential. It's very attractive. Kagyutay lang na nga, you introduce it even in small doses, it will surely rise. It will spread. And that is why, to me, it's very dangerous. I find it very dangerous because of its power to be influential and to spread, in the words of St. Paul, to spread like gangrene. Okay? I don't have to explain that. Ang importante lang, ka-dangerous, gid sini sang false teaching, kay tungod nga grabe, gid siya ka-influential. Now, the question is, why is it very influential? Why is a gospel that sets aside the work and centrality of Christ in favor of the exaltation of the self, why is it so popular? Ginhambal, gintudlo na ni Paul, ginwarningan niya na kita. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching, for the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own what? What's the answer for the influence of this kind of teaching? Their own passions. It caters to people's desires. It caters to the desires of the self for everything. Happiness, self-esteem, self-worth, achievement, success, a comfortable life, money. This is not the only verse where Paul speaks about something like this. Okay, let's go to another verse. Let the Bible teach us. Listen to the word of God. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verses 1 to 5. But understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. This is telling, very significant. Having the appearance of godliness, but denying its power. And so deceptive at the same time, because it passes itself as a Christian teaching. I do not have time to go deep into that, but I will just trust the Holy Spirit to be the one to speak to our hearts and to open our eyes. Why do you think that it can even be embraced by Christians if it did not have some kind of Christian veneer or biblical veneer? But in the end, you know that is false teaching. It sets aside the gospel. It exalts self because it caters to the passions, the desires of the self. Lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness, but no power. The Spirit is not there. I have more to say about that in a little while. But we go now to the next point. Two more points to go, so please bear with me. Okay, I know this is not... This is supposed to be a prayer meeting, but this is God's word, so I'm going to ask a little more patience. Where are we? We are now in verse 10. I have confidence in the Lord that you will take no other view, and the one who is troubling you will bear the penalty, whoever he is. Teachers of the gospel, preachers of the gospel, we should be very afraid, because false teaching will be punished. It will be punished. According to the book of James, James chapter 3, verse 1, not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. We will be judged. And among the members of the church, we will be first, we who teach. So we have to be very careful. Are we preaching the gospel or not? Now, if you want to know what the punishment is, Jesus makes that clear. Matthew 24:45 to 51. Let me read. Who Who then is the faithful and wise servant whom his master has set over his household to give them their food at the proper time? Blessed is the servant whom his master will find so doing when he comes. What is this good servant doing? Giving them their food at the proper time. Truly I say to you, set him over all his possessions. But if that wicked servant says to himself, my master is delayed, and begins to beat his fellow servants, eats and drinks with drunkards, the master of that servant will come on a day when he does not expect him, and at an hour he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and put him with the hypocrites in that place. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I am frightened. I do not know. Maybe I might forget and I might preach something else rather than the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this might be the result. But anyway, last point. But if I, brother, still preach circumcision, why am I still being persecuted? In that case, the offense of the cross has been removed. Verse 12, I have already expounded, so I will just focus on verse 11. Fifth characteristic of false teaching is it removes the offense of the cross. When the gospel is faithfully and truly preached, it cannot help but offend. Now, I am not talking about human offensiveness. That is wrong. Sometimes people have offensive personalities. And I confess, sometimes I fall into that category. And I ask God to forgive me and help me get away from that. But I'm not talking about the offensiveness of personality. I am talking about the offense of the cross. When the gospel is being preached, it will offend people. You know why? Because it will oppose what they want. Let's look at some verses. The cross, what is this offense of the cross? Why is the preaching of the gospel offensive? Because the cross is about crucifying the flesh, not gratifying its desires. May I repeat that? The cross is about crucifying the flesh. That's why it's the cross. The cross is about crucifying the flesh, not gratifying the desires of the flesh. Galatians 5:24. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Then number two, the message of the cross is offensive. The gospel is offensive when it is faithfully preached. Why? Because it is about denying oneself instead of fulfilling oneself. What does Luke, you already know this, Luke 9:23-24, what does the Bible say? He said to all, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Deny yourself, take up the cross. Whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. The irony is, when you try to save your life, you will lose it. But when you lose it, give up everything for Christ, embrace Him as your Lord and Savior, you will find what you are looking for. Maybe in a future sermon, I might expound more about this. Because there is an irony involved here. People are basing their joy, happiness, self-worth on the things that they might gain or achieve. But ironically, it's in giving all those things up that you will find the true treasure, which is most and eternally satisfying, Christ Jesus Himself. Okay, I'll just read this. Luke 10:21-22. I'm sorry, I chose the wrong verse. Never mind that. But you remember the rich young ruler, ambal ni Jesus, say, okay, you want to gain eternal life? Sell all you have! Sell all you have, all your possessions! Give to the poor and come, follow me. And the Bible says he turned away. He was so sad because he had a lot of possessions. Okay. So that's it. Let's go to the conclusion. Praise the Lord. At least I don't know if I think I still have exceeded 30 minutes. But let me just close with a verse that is really very important regarding preaching the gospel, preaching the word of God. Jeremiah 23:25. I have heard what the prophets have said who prophesy lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed, I have dreamed. How long shall there be lies in the heart of the prophets who prophesy lies and who prophesy the deceit of their own heart? Who think to make my people forget my name by their dreams that they tell one another, even as their fathers forget my name for Baal? Let the prophet who has a dream tell the dream, but let him who has my word speak my word faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat? What has human wisdom in common with the powerful word of God? What is human psychology, emotional management, and all those other things compared to the power of God in His word? Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks the rock in pieces? Therefore, behold, I am against the prophets, declares the Lord, who steal my words from one another. Behold, I am against the prophets, declares the Lord, who use their tongue and declare, declares the Lord. Behold, I am against those who prophesy lying dreams, declares the Lord, and who tell and lead my people astray by their lies and their recklessness, when I did not send them or charge them. So they do not profit these people at all. The problem with human wisdom is that it does not profit, it does not feed the people. There will still be a spiritual famine. Let me close with this story. I mentioned in the beginning of this devotional, I mentioned that I have the privilege of sharing God's word to my relatives in San Pablo City via Zoom, and I'm very happy about that. That is a rare privilege, you know, to be a prophet in your own country. And you know what? Ang background sina Amuni. These relatives of mine are my first cousins who are the children of my father's eldest sister. Ang natabo, 30 to 40 years ago, my father was saved. And he shared the gospel with everyone. He shared the gospel. Ining pamilya nini, mga pakaisa ko, tiya ko, wala sila nagbaton kay Kristo. Wala. Di sila. My father died 20 years ago. 40 years after he shared the gospel, 20 years after nga napatay siya, ining mga pakaisa ko turned to Christ and were saved. Kag nagatestimony sila via Zoom nga nadumduman nila si Daddy nga nagplant sang seed kag subong luwas na sila. And they contacted me and asked me, Dennis, can you continue the ministry of your father? Nga mag-share sang gospel sa amon. 40 years ago, he shared the gospel with them. He did not live to see the result. But God honored His word. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved and your family. Because my father preached the gospel. 40 years after, ako naman ang nagbulos. And if you ask me, Brother Dennis, why do you love the gospel? I love the gospel because I love my father who shared the gospel with me, and I love my Heavenly Father who sent Jesus Christ to be my Savior and Lord. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. My family is saved, both father's side and mother's side. Some 40 years after the gospel was shared, but they were saved because the gospel is powerful. Thank you, Lord. I just commit this message to you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.